I just so delighted that everybody got in because, lucky enough, for some people didn't turn up. So I'm just pleased to see you all here, and you're all very, very welcome. So at first I would like to introduce James Durney, our local historian, and his lovely wife here, who has to put up with all the talks every time. Caroline, you're welcome as well. This is a very special occasion for us here in Kilcullen. And of course we have a very special person here in the audience. It's a place I think he may have memories of himself, so I leave them to you, Christy, to give your memories. You might share them later on with us, okay? So, you, as I said, you are all very welcome, and I'll hand you over now to James Durney. Thank you.
Thank you, Nessa. I first came across Frank Conroy nearly 20 years ago, around the year 2000, while researching for my book on the One Road, Political Unrest in Kildare. Mick O'Riordan's book, Conley Column, published in 1979, had several mentions of Frank Conroy, including that he was from Kildare. There were no other details, just Kildare. And most people assume when it does not say County Kildare, then it is Kildare Town. So an assumption grew up that Frank Conroy was born in Kildare Town. Because of the song Viva la Quinta Brigada, one of my favourites, I might add, I contacted its author, Christy Moore, through my uncle, Timmy Durney, who had played football for Moorfield with Christy. He in turn contacted Spanish Civil War veteran Mick O'Riordan on my behalf to ask if he knew Frank Conroy. Mick's reply was that he did not get to know Frank Conroy, as Frank was only in Spain for 14 days before he was killed in action. On a trip to the National Library for mentions of Frank Conroy, I consulted several of the newspapers of the day, including the Irish Democrat, the Conley Association's flagship newspaper, along with contemporary newspapers like the Irish Independent, Irish Press and Irish Times. They all had the same byline, Frank Conroy, Kildare. At a dead end, I did the same as everyone else and recorded Frank Conroy as Kildare only. In 2008, I published an article on our library website, eHistory Kildare, on Kildare men and women on both sides of the political divide, which was also published on the Ireland and the Spanish Civil War website. Not giving up, in 2013, we made an appeal through our library website for the birthplace of Frank Conroy. Further research by Mario Corrigan and I led to two leads, a birth for a Francis Conroy in January-March 1914 in the registration district of Naas, and the birth of a Francis Conroy in July-September 1917 in the registration district of Attoy. So armed with this information, I headed to the General Registration Office in Dublin to finally track down Frank Conroy's birthplace, which is then confirmed as Kilcullen, which is in the registration district of Naas. Frank Conroy was born on the 25th of February 1914 in Kilcullen, County Kildare, and baptised on the 1st of March 1914. His parents were Michael Conroy, born in County Laois, and Catherine Farrell, born in County Dublin. They married in St Andrew's Church, Westland Row, Dublin, in 1908. Michael Conroy was a baker by trade, and in the 1911 census he was living with his wife and two children, John, two, and Mary, an infant, in the Guinness Trust buildings in Patrick Street, Dublin. Michael Conroy moved his family to County Kildare shortly after, probably for employment reasons, after a large bakery, O'Connell's, operating in Kilcullen. It was here another child was added to the family, Francis. Frank Conroy received his confirmation in Sandymount, Dublin, on the 15th of March 1928, which indicates that the family had at some stage moved back to Dublin. Frank Conroy left for Spain on the Dunleary Holyhead ferry on the 13th of December 1936 with about 25 other Irish volunteers, including Frank Ryan. The men were ex-members of the IRA, the Irish Citizen Army, Irish Republican Congress, and the Six County Socialist Party. Many of them, but not all, were communists. Frank Conroy was a former IRA volunteer and a member of the Communist Party of Ireland. He gave no next of kin. Walter Greenlee from Manchester met Ryan's party on the ferry from Britain to France and said, The Irish Merlin were in high spirits, singing rebel songs in the bar. 13 men, including Frank Conroy, crossed the border into Spain on buses during the night of the 14th of December. Within days, 7 of them would be dead. The Irish volunteers left for the Cordoba front on Christmas Eve. Their task was to capture the town of Lopeira. They were machine gunned from the air on Christmas Day and had to withdraw from their positions outside Lopeira. Another attempt was made to encircle the town on the 28th of December. However, the reinforced and well-fortified enemy forces again resisted strongly. As the badly equipped men of the International Battalion tried to cross the ridges in front of the town, they were subject to machine gun fire and artillery bombardment and had to retreat. In total, 300 volunteers from 19 nations were killed and another 600 were wounded in the disastrous attack. 5 men from Dublin, 1 from Galway, and Frank Conroy from Kildare were killed. Almost all the other Irish volunteers in the unit were wounded. Frank Conroy died from gunshot and shrapnel wounds to the head. On Christmas Eve, the company had been 145 strong. When they returned to Albacete the following month, only 67 men remained. Last year, I was invited by McKeely to speak at the James Connolly birthday commemoration in Dublin's Temple Theatre, where a plaque to honour the Irish Republican Socialist dead of the Spanish Civil War was offered to County Kildare by the Friends of the International Brigades, who had erected a similar plaque in Lopeira, Spain. As Kilcullen was the birthplace of one of those mentioned on the plaque, Frank Conroy, we thought it fitting that it should be erected there. And as Kilcullen was celebrating its 700 years as a community, Mario Corrigan suggested that I contact Nessid and Lee to offer the plaque as part of the town's festivities. I would like to thank my colleagues in the local studies department and genealogy, Mario Corrigan and Carol Kiley, and for Mick Healy, who first, and for Donald Higgins then, for that photo, the wonderful photo you've seen of Frank Conroy. Tonight, thanks to everyone involved, we will unveil this plaque to a hero of the International Brigades, Frank Conroy from Kilcullen. Thank you. No, that's all right.
Is there anybody want to ask a question or anything before James sits down? You all going to be real quiet? Yes, yeah, Kevin.
With them being members of the Irish Communist Party, how did they end up in Spain? You know, by the end of it, how did he end up dying in Spain if he was part of that front?
Well, we're fighting against the fascists.
Okay.
Communists and socialists were fighting against Franco's fascists. So they had volunteered to fight with the international brigades against the rise of fascism in Spain.
Okay, thank you, James. Thanks very much. I'm an O'Connor, and it was my grandfather and my father's bakery. And the man in the van, the photograph there, was my father. So in the connection, I was so thrilled when James rang me and asked me about, you know, doing this for the Kilcullen 700. From just as chairperson of the Kilcullen 700, I was delighted. But the fact that the connection with the family, it was very special. So thank you, James, for that. And I really appreciated doing it for it. Now, we're talking about Kilcullen 700. I'll start with that first. The first bridge ever built over the Liffey here in Kilcullen was in 1319 by a Canon Morris Jacobs, and he actually built a bridge in Loughlin Bridge as well. And that was how the community started. In a tower of Old Kilcullen, as you might all know of, coming out the Carlow Road, you'll see it if you're going towards the Old Carlow Road, on your right hand side you'll see this round tower. And that's where the community was originally. So all of a sudden in 1319, there's a bridge built. Oh, it's not the bridge that's there now, but it was the first bridge. And so, of course, once with water and the bridge and everything, that's how a community starts. So that was how the Kilcullen that I know here now started. And we felt that 700 years ago is something we should celebrate, not just for a day, not just for a month. We decided for the whole year. So we're actually after having a great celebration, and I think most of you coming in may have looked at the bridge, the display of the knitwork there. Now I have to thank the June Fest people,
and McKeely, of course, for really helping us along the way. Because of this, it was because of the Drum Fest that this came about, and they were sharing the plaque with us here in Kilcullen. But also the knitters in Newbridge had already started this tradition of knitting and decorating along the Linear Park, is it? That's in Newbridge. So in, early on this year, I went over to the knitters in the library, found out where they were meeting, and asked them, would they come over to our knitting club here in Kilcullen, which was a small number of people, would they come over and just have a chat with them? They came over, and after about, I'd say only 2 hours, the women here in Kilcullen took off, and that's all I can. They grew, they all of a sudden, about nearly 30, was it, Miriam? It ended up about 30 members of a knitting club here. And they're actually going into the schools now, helping in the schools to continue the tradition. And it's our heritage as well, if you think about it. But what they put together, I mean, it's fantastic. I would actually advise you all, when you're coming out from here, if it's still bright, go out by the, down by the river there in under the bridge and have a look at some of the knitting that's in under the bridge as well, down along the bank. I mean, it's absolute. For how they did it, I don't know. And I really want to pay our Suez Knitting Club a great compliment, because that's one of the things we did. But it's a great, as I said, a compliment to the ladies who it is decorated. Then you might have seen Kilcullen in bloom. Did you see all the lovely flowers coming that? There's the Kilcullen Community Action. We have a very strong community action group here in Kilcullen, and they are responsible for planting. They actually planted all those boxes themselves. Now the people, the business people do help out. They actually have self-watering system put in, so the boxes, they are self-watering. So you can feel how passionate I am about Kilcullen. And it's something I'm just so proud of, you know. And so when you see what people working together, you know, it's really, that says it all, doesn't it? You know, that we're together, we're invincible. And that's what that means. So that is just giving you the little bit of history on Kilcullen 700. We have different talks every month. We have a Memories Monday. Every second Monday, the second Monday of every month for the whole year, Mary Offord is organising what we call Memory Mondays. And people just come in, share their memories for an hour, 2 hours. And it's amazing. It started off about 8. Now I think there's 20 or 30 people coming in. And it's usually people of my age and that are sharing their memories. But it's a lovely way of growing together. So that was it. So I just wanted then to tell you a little bit about the history here of the hall here. This hall was, and Christy will remember it, in the 60s, but it was built in the 1930s. And my aunt, who were the home place in the bakery, was just actually here next door. So if we have to do a fast exit, you're actually going into where the bakery was. So in the 1930s, they had no community in the hall in the town. This was what was called the burnt building. It was a drapery, and it had been burnt down, and all the deeds had burnt with it. So nobody could buy it. My grandfather actually tried to buy it, but there was no deeds, so they didn't sell it. So obviously then they decided, well, we'll give it to the community. Now they did have to pay for it, but at a nominal fee. So it was built here in the 1933, this hall was built. It was the first night they had it opened it, they had a dress dance. And because it was a galvanised roof, they were all the hot air and everything, the drops. My aunt told me this used to drop down the condensation because of the galvanised roof. And you think of them all in all of their finery and this happening. But that was in the 1930s. So, I mean, it was a great facility to have in our town. It continued there in the 19, it grew then from that. We did have a bit of a problem in that there was an insurance claim at one stage, would you believe it, in the late 30s, 40s, and it changed hands for a while, but then it came back into community again. Now, the pit was where the youngsters went, where they used to be throwing things down on top of them. Would you remember any of that, Christy? The pips or whatever be thrown down to the one in the pit. Then the very comfortable people would be in the middle aisle, and all the curtain went on up in the balcony. So it was a great source of a social outlet for us all. I have to give credit to Paddy Melia. Paddy Melia was a great manager, and he got huge films here for us. With the first, they were only landed really, and we'd have the main films down here. Then we also had the Bachelors, we had the Wolf Tones, I think we had the Artane Boys Band even he had here. So that sort of was in the 60s. That place went very well, doing very well. And then it went in, as it happens, into disrepair. Now, the Kilcullen was divided into six areas, and each area put on an hour and a half show. We had to come up with our own ideas, and we had to then put it on you two nights. The first night was a dress rehearsal, and the second night was the real thing. And we paid for adjudicators to come down from Dublin to actually adjudicate on the shows. And that happened for 10 years. We nearly had more marriages broken up and whatever, I can tell you, by the time we were finished, because we got so, how would you say, professional about our shows. It caused a lot of problems. But it was a great source of keeping this place going and for buying the valley, which we have now as a local amenity. So then in the 90s, it was really in a bad way. And my late husband, who was very passionate about Kilcullen, as I am, he got involved with the renovation. So we sort of reduced the seats and we brought the screen, which the screen would have been brought back here. It used to be at the back wall. And that went on for a while. And he decided then that, if we needed something a little bit more. So you look at the lovely seats you're sitting in. There's not too many theatres in Ireland, is there? Comfortable seats like that? Well, my man did not believe, and John Smith, you can verify it there. He did not believe nothing was impossible. In his area, everything is possible. Nothing's a problem. It's only a solution. So he was wondering what he was going to do about the seats. They'd taken out the old seats, but in actual fact, we've kept one right up at the very end just to show what the seats were like in those days. But anyway, he was over, just involved with the renovation of the theatre here, and it was over. He was a garage man, and he was over at the launch of a Volvo in Ireland, or in Sweden. And in Sweden, they were showing the new car, which is an S60 at the time, and they had seats and they had a screen. And he was sitting at these seats and, I wonder what could be done here. So he said, what are you going to do with these seats when they're finished? And they thought, this was true, they Volvo Ireland, of course. They said, well, we'll recycle them. Well, I'll recycle them for you, he said. So he kept after them and after them, and after about, I'd say, 6 months, with the help of Volvo Ireland, where whole wooden crates arrived here. With I don't know many, actually, the wooden crates, many, but there was 114 Volvo leather seats, free, gratis, and for nothing from Volvo. So, I mean, it's a great story, and there, as I say, there's not too many seats like that.
He was born in Kilcullen town, where a hill goes up and a hill goes down. And his eyes were blue, his hair was brown. A young man named Frank Conroy. 1936 in Spain, he went to fight in freedom's name, but he never came back home again. A young man named Frank Conroy. I don't know. For he joined the International Brigade, and he went to the People's Aid. A young man named Frank Conroy. 3 days after Christmas Day, on a hillside far, far away, outnumbered and outgunned, they say, a young man named Frank Conroy. Men and women heard the call, they went to fight for the good of. Damn, then he died there and
I was asked to sing two songs, so I'll have to. Normally I'd sing four or five. Oh, without the sub, yeah. Now, this is a different song altogether. It's about wandering. Contract, I can't sing anymore. Wasn't that great? Huh? Yeah, well, here, get arrested if I sang that. You want me to go?
Would you like to sing one more, Paul?
Thank you. on a floor in Donegal a long, long time ago, after leaving a pub, maybe. I don't know what day it was, or what year it was, or what morning it was, but anyway. And I wrote this song, and if I can remember it, I'll sing it. There's screaming women everywhere. They're drunk as hell and they don't care. The men are crazy, so beware. Way past closing time. Someone fell off his seat. Didn't land on his feet. They're outside fighting in the street. It's way past closing time. Right there, ladies and gents, please. Get that man up off his knees. When you're drunk, and you're drunker than a skunk, you can't resist you, you're a hunk. It's way past closing time. Where's your coat now? You can't think. You know you've had too much to drink. Your life is going down the sink, and it's way past closing time. Very catchy chorus. Right there, ladies and gents, please get that man up off his knees. Oh no, I lost my keys. Past closing time. It's the maddest time of night. The town is spoiling for a fight. We're arguing that black and white. Way past closing time. Someone calls for another beer. Someone's yakking in your ear. A load of shite you don't want to hear. And it's way past closing time. You'd love that, wouldn't you? Bullets flying there earlier on.
I appreciate it, Paul, on behalf of the
song. Thank
you very much for being here. I'll buy you a drink after. I'm in choir, our own local Kilcullen Gospel Choir now, under the baton of Lorraine Nolan, who is from Newbridge as well. So the Newbridge, the Kilcullen, or the June Fest, and the Kilcullen 700 are certainly celebrating. And I know Noel Heavey is here tonight. Noel, congratulations getting into the council. Don't forget to look after us here in Kilcullen as well. Also, as I say, I know you've done a lot of work over the years. I'm glad it paid off you, and thank you for all your work to date. There's a few things I'd just like to thank. Are you coming down there?
Yes,
there. Okay, just give me time to do it. Michael Healy, thank you very much for all your help. It's been a great source of bringing me in and organising things. Very much appreciated, Mick. To the Friends of the International Brigade Ireland, for the Frank Conroy Plaque. To Harry Owens, for the Spanish Civil War historian, for his help and encouragement over the years. To John Higgins, Baz, Eugene, Terry Moore. And also we wanted to mention that Joan Carty, niece of whose mother was Eileen, was Frank's youngest sister. We thank her for her help as well. So without further ado, look at these beauties. You're very welcome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Our wonderful Kilcullen Gospel Choir.
And the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck, and you're not moving anywhere. You thought you found a friend to take you out of this place, someone you could lend a hand in a turn for grace. It's a beautiful day.
Modern world, or do you need more? And This, there's a special man here that definitely knows the words of this song. It's called Curve Kildare, and please join in with us.
Now, you just practiced yesterday, so there's words. Okay, you ready?
The winter it is past, and the summer's come at last, and the
very, very much for inviting me to be part of this wonderful event. And just to share a little bit with you, recently I've realised that I started going to school in Newbridge when I was 4 years of age. I went to the nuns. When I was 10, I went to the brothers, the Christian brothers. And then I went to the Dominican priests. And they had me for 14 years, and never once did they mention Frank Conroy or the Spanish Civil War. And neither did they mention Republican prisoners that were hanged in Newbridge just 30 years previously. Never mentioned, never heard anything about it. It's only when I got Mick O'Riordan's book, and of course I should say that Mick's son and daughter are here tonight, Amanis and Brenda. It's great to see you in Kildare.
Thank you.
And yeah. Val and I and our children were in Spain in the early 80s, and I was reading the Connolly column by Mick O'Riordan. And it was then I got a little bit of insights into the Spanish Civil War. And subsequent to that, I learned that Frank Conroy was from Kilcullen. And not only that, but he worked in O'Connell's. And I knew O'Connell's in Newbridge, and I knew of the O'Connell's in Kilcullen. I have lots of memories of this beautiful town going way back. When I was a small lad, when I was 11, my father died, and the Burns up at the hideout, Mrs. Byrne was friendly with my mother Nancy, and they used to invite me out to the house to meet Brian Byrne, whom we all know. And Brian then was a budding young scientist, and he had a big box of scientific equipment, and I used to come out to the hideout and play with Brian until one day we nearly blew the whole place up.
The dry light bomb. He asked you, Christy, that you would particularly remember him because he can't be here this evening, that you would tell the story of the car by bomb.
That's it. Obviously it's told now, I've just told it. I think we have a bit of a double act going on here. Yeah, and then of course I went to school with Peter and John Barden and with one of the Orfords. And I also remember back then growing up in Newbridge, there was an amazing boxing club here in Kilcullen, which included many Irish champions and indeed one European champion, the late Colin McCoy. But I remember Henry Peacock and the Aspels and Stephen Schwyer and all those wonderful boxers of that era. But we're here tonight to remember Frank Conroy. And like the courage it took for those men to leave Ireland and go across England, and many of them to cross the Pyrenees into Spain, not knowing where they were going, but knowing that they were going to fight fascism. And of course, we have a rise of fascism around the world again now. The world is changing again, so let's hope there are people as courageous as Frank Ryan to face the fascists down. And 10 years before I saw the light of morning, a comradeship of heroes was laid. From every corner of the world came sailing the 15th International Brigade. They came to stand beside the Spanish people, to try and stem the rising fascist tide. Franco's allies were the Kilcullens and Plaque. Frank Ryan's men came from the other side. Even the Arabs were bleeding. As the battle for Madrid it thundered on, to root in love against the force of evil, brotherhood against the fascist clan. Viva la Quinta Brigada, no pass around the pledge that made us fight. Adelante is the cry around the hillside. Let us remember them tonight. Bob Hillard was a Church of Ireland pastor. From Killarney across the Pyrenees he came. From Derry came a brave young Christian brother. Side by side they fought and died in Spain.
and Tommy Woods at 17 died in Cordoba. With the Fianna Fáil learned to hold a gun, from Dublin to the Via del Rio, where he fought and died beneath the Spanish sun. Viva the Kings of Regatta, no pass around the pledge that made him mad. Adamante is the cry around the hillside. Let us remember them tonight. But many Irish heard the call of Franco, joined Hitler, Mussolini too. Propaganda from the pulpit and newspapers helped Doug Duffy to gather up his crew. Oh, the word came from the church support the Nazis. Men of clots, they failed again. When the bishops blessed the blue shirts down in Galway, as they sailed beneath the swastika to Spain. Viva the Kings of Regatta, no pass around the pledge that made him fight. Adelante is the cry around the hillside. Let us remember them tonight. This song is a tribute to Frank Ryan, Kit Conway, Denny Cody too, Peter Daly, Charlie Reagan, and Hugh Bonner. How many died, I can but never feel. Danny Boyle, Blazer Brown, and Charlie Dundee. Liam Tomlinson and Jim Straney from Short Strand. Jack Nulty, Tommy Patton, and Frank Conroy. Jim Foley, Tony Fox, and Nicole. Viva la Quinta Vergara, no pass around the pledge that men will fight. Adelante is the cry around the hillside. Let us remember them tonight. Viva la Quinta Vergara, let us remember them tonight.
Great balladeer from Macroom, and when I sing this song I often think about the courage of those who went to fight in Spain. The song is called Ride On. Ride on, see you, I could never go with you no matter how I wanted to. And you know, I still am in awe of what it took for Frank to leave Kilcullen and make that journey. If any of the choir have this, come out and sing Ride On with me, will you?
Yeah, we want. Well,
I've ever seen standing 16, one or two, with eyes wide and green. You ride the horse so well, hands light to the touch. I could never go with you no matter how I wanted to. Right
into the night without a trace behind. Run your claw along my gut one last time. I turned to face an empty space where you used to lie, and look for the spark that lights the night through a teardrop in my eye.
Where is
the ring